I'm Rick Emerson. Welcome to Outlook Portland. They are both seen and unseen. They are on the surface, but sometimes out of sight. They are tattoos, and in Portland, they are everywhere, even if you don't necessarily see them. Hi, I'm Rick Emerson, and welcome to Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV. There are a great many times in my life, let's say somewhere between 95 and 98% of the time, when I feel somewhat bland and uninteresting. That has now risen to 100% as I sit here resplendent in my brown button-up shirt next to two representatives from the Gypsy Queens, who are an organization in Portland that strives to recreate and redefine the sometimes sullied image of the tattoo aficionado. Anywhere near correct?
Pretty much.
Excellent. So, because I want to make sure that these are given correctly the first time, and I will undoubtedly mangle them, will you introduce yourselves?
I'm Queen Pirate, the Oregon Chapter President.
And I'm Rock and Roll Ruby, the Oregon Chapter Vice President.
I have no such interesting name, so I will call you now for the duration of the program Ms. Pirate, or Ms. Queen, Ms. Rock, etc. Before we go any further, I should ask how, as your parents probably said at some point, how did a nice girl like you and you, how did you come to this place in your lives? When did you decide that you wanted to use yourself as a canvas of some kind?
I kind of feel like my tattoos are a charter of my life.
In what sense? In that they're tracking you as you sort of go through different phases of...
Every big thing in my life, every triumph, every pitfall, every good thing, every bad thing, every molehill, mountain is kind of on my body.
Does that mean there'll be a small Outlook Portland tattoo put somewhere
later on
this afternoon?
That's right.
Excellent. I can check that off my things to do list. And Ruby, the same question for you.
I pretty much mirror what she is saying. I'm not anywhere near as advanced as she is in the artwork on the body yet, but that's a yet. I will be soon. And it's the same thing. It's just a representation of different stages of my life. And also, I've just always been a very big fan of art, and I think that it's a beautiful display, if done right, to put on your body.
I remember reading The Illustrated Man by Ray Bradbury when I was a kid and just being fascinated by the concept of literally that every tattoo sort of told a story. And although I'm just a phenomenal baby when it comes to pain and anything that's sort of remotely related to pain, I've never done anything like this, but I think a lot of people, they probably wish that they could. They wish that they could take the plunge into doing something creative with themselves like this. Does it get to be something that you are compelled to do? Does it get to be sort of a more than a lifestyle, something like an addiction? I've heard it described that way.
I think more or less, instead of an addiction, I'm a collector. Like, people collect things and items, like, you know, some people have cars or couches or special furniture, and I collect art.
So when you say you're trying to refine or revise the image that people have of the tattooing lifestyle, where does that come from? What was the motivation for that?
I believe sometimes there's a negative connotation that goes along with women in tattooing due to some certain organizations that will sort of exploit tattooed women, as far as, you know, they think that, you know, women need to get nude to show off their tattoos and be attractive that way. And I think there's other ways to go about showing off your art than taking off your clothes.
And that brings us to the organization itself, to the Gypsy Queens. So how did it start? When did it start?
It was Frankie Scorpion, and she's on the East Coast in New York, and she started it to pretty much empower women, because you can see a lot of women in, like, the working industry were pretty much looked at as, you know, they're not good enough because they make poor choices, or I think a lot of the time tattoos go along with the stereotype of, you know, people in bad organizations are like, oh, they're just old, you know, bikers or streetwalkers and such. But we're actually moms, and we're, you know, in the workforce. We're doctors, we're lawyers, we're, you know, under lawyer suits, they actually have full body suits of art, beautiful art.
That is one of the things about tattoos, that they're on the surface, but they're sometimes out of sight. Mm-hmm. And you never really know, you know, what's kind of lurking underneath there sometimes. I know people that have gotten tattoos because they wanted to make sure that they didn't return to some normal 9-to-5 job. I have a friend of mine who actually just got something very loud and gaudy. I'll put it that way. It was a combination of like skulls and fire, and there was like a pentagram at some point, and I think Lemmy from Motorhead. And I said, that's sort of interesting, Bob. Why'd you get that done? He said, I just don't want to go work in an insurance office ever, and this guarantees that I won't do that. Do you find that that's the case, that having a certain amount of tattoo art does keep you from going to a certain place in your life that maybe you don't want to, attitudinally?
I can agree with that statement, due to the fact that I have stars on my face. Kind of keeps me...
I hadn't noticed.
That kind of keeps you from that run-of-the-mill, very, conservative lifestyle job. You know, I can't go and work in corporate America and, you know, represent a big five-star lawyer company or something like that, but I like to do what I like to do, and it lets me know that I'd rather strive to go further and be more on the outside of things than just go with the main flow.
Do you think that the recent sort of fetishizing of tattoos, and you mentioned, I mean, there's a lot of, I think with the internet, there's a lot of niche, websites, a lot of niche organizations have emerged that sort of that merge tattooing and a sort of hypersexuality together, to where people have come to think that they're sort of indistinguishable from one another. Do you think that's impacted negatively the image of people who have tattoos, that there is, as you said, this a perception problem?
I think nowadays, more or less, people are more apt to get tattoos than not.
And do you think that's because there's just a more generalized acceptance of it? Do you think they've become so present and they're so widespread that any sort of stigma has just become lessened because of that?
I think there's more of a fascination than there is like a stigma. I mean, I think there's still like a taboo around it. You know, you won't see just anybody going in to get a tattoo, but it's a little pleasing to me when I go into a tattoo parlor and I see like, you know, your average soccer mom's going and getting tattooed. It really makes me happy. It lets me know that it's becoming more socially acceptable.
How many people are in the organization now, the Gypsy Queens?
Nationally, there's over 4,000 of us.
Really? Yes. And when was it founded?
It was founded approximately about 5 to 8 years ago.
When we come back, we'll talk more about the Gypsy Queens and about the tattooing lifestyle as it relates to Portland. You're watching Outlook Portland right here on Northwest 32 TV. Stay right there.